Hi, everyone. I'm glad we've got a big group today. This is Dina Sokolow, and I'm in charge. One of the things that I do here at Baker Donelson is I work with the programming on our webinars. And when I was looking at the summer, I thought, you know, there's a lot of issues in wage and hour that come up that the attorneys here at Baker, the L&E attorneys, deal with in the summer, particularly with summer hires and internship programs. What can we do? What can we not do? On top of that, there's been some developments in the law we're going to talk about today. For those of you who are in service businesses that use tip pooling, we're going to talk a little bit about how the tip pooling law has changed. And even for those of you who don't do tipping, it's kind of interesting to see where the Department of Labor is going with this, because it kind of is giving us some insight as to some other changes that we're going to see coming down the pike. And I'm going to tell you, we had the Department of Labor recently came out with a regulatory agenda, and we are going to talk about what is on the agenda going forward for the Department of Labor. I'm going to talk about a couple of Supreme Court cases. I so appreciate everybody who submitted in advance questions. Some of them I'm going to get to, and some of them I'm not. We're not really going to talk about in detail about the exemptions from overtime today. I'm going to talk a little bit about where I think the law is going. But, you know, if you want to follow up with me one-on-one, I'll have my email again at the end. Or we're also going to take a lot of the questions that we got and look for our future programming. So just a few housekeeping things before we get started substantively. You know, there's questions. You can submit questions. There's a Q&A box. I will try to get to them. I always try. I'll stay around a little bit at the end if I don't get to all of them. And if I don't get to your question, then we're going to, I promise that I will, you can email me directly and I will try my best to answer them. Also, there's a blue survey box at the end. I really encourage you to please fill it out. It gives us insight into what you like, what you don't like, and there's also a question on there about future programming, and we're constantly trying to stay on top of what people are looking for in these webinars, and we look at the questions and we do look at the suggestions for future programming. I always get this question. We'll get it multiple times. Not even though I'm saying this, I'm going to get the question anyway, but I'm going to say it again. You will get a copy of the slides, and there'll be a recording as well. The recording will be posted on Baker Donelson's website, and you will get a thank you email if you've registered that will have a link to the slides. So if you want to go back through the slides. So that is it. And there's a little thing with follow us on Twitter or LinkedIn to the L&E section of Baker. So let's start with talking about summer hires. You know, when we're there's a lot of, let's face it, cheap personnel out there we can get for the summer. Kids are off school and they're looking for jobs, and you know, we want to, you know, it's a great time to take advantage of that, and especially if it's you're in an industry that's particularly busy in the summer. So what governs this? What do we need to take into account? And primarily, you know, we're talking about wage and hour issues. We're always going to be talking about the Fair Labor Standards Act. That's the federal law that governs wage and hour. And we, you know, if any of you, I recognize a lot of the names. You guys have been to my webinars before when we talked about the overtime exemptions. And we always talk about that the FLSA governs overtime and minimum wage, but it also has youth employment provisions in it that talk about what you can and can't do when you hire minors. And this is not just in the summer. This is any time during the year. And so generally, and we're going to talk about exceptions, but generally when you hire minors, they're entitled to minimum wage and overtime if they work over 40. However, there are restrictions on hours, and we're going to talk about that. Really, can't work most of them overtime. And then there's some extra protections as well. But also, you need to think about and look into your state laws. I'm going to give you some examples of what a state law might say on it, but obviously I can't, you know, the people who attend this webinar are from all over the country, so we can't go into each state law, but some states often are more restrictive than federal law on employment of minors. And what's interesting is a lot of the states, especially the ones that are in Baker Donelson's footprints, these southern states, that normally just kind of mirror the Fair Labor Standards Act. They don't have more restriction wage, you don't see more wage and hour restrictions in Georgia or Tennessee or Florida. Some of those states actually are more restrictive when it comes to employment of minors. But if we look, we're going to look at the issues. They are usually more flexible during the summer times when school is out. So when we look at state laws, some of the examples, I just kind of pulled a few of the state laws to look at what the states are saying. We're going to talk about the federal government in a second. But, you know, this is just some samples. Like in Georgia, minors under 12 flat out prohibited from working. Florida, minors under 16, they can't conduct door-to-door sales. All minors are entitled to a 30-minute rest break before 4 hours of continuous work. Florida really doesn't have any laws like that with regard to adults, so that's kind of an unusual thing. Same with Tennessee. Minors can't work at heights greater than 10 feet off the ground, so no minors in construction jobs, and must be given 30-minute rest breaks no earlier than 1 hour into work and before 6 hours of continuous work. Alabama's got work saying 16 and 17-year-olds can work, but they have very specific time restrictions in Alabama for 14 and 15-year-olds. North Carolina is kind of interesting. I just grabbed that one because that one says they can work anytime, 16 and 17-year-olds, but you just need to get parental permission for it. Also, some of the states require work permits or age certificates, and that's just a way, and we're going to talk about that too going forward. It's a way, especially when someone is not 16 yet and maybe they don't have any, you know, you're not sure about the employee's age. This is a sanctioned document that shows exactly how old the employee is. So if somebody's trying to do something that they're maybe not old enough for, it gives you as an employer a modicum of protection from employing underage workers. So when we're talking about the federal government now, the FLSA, the labor restrictions are very strict and detailed. And generally what they go to are two things. What the employee is doing, the task the employer is performing, and then the number of hours that they're doing it. And they separate it out by age. So there's rules for under 18, there's rules for under 16, and there's rules for under 14. So depending on an employee's age is what they can and can't do for you. Also, and we're going to get into this next, but there's limited exceptions for apprentices and student learners. This is something that is on the regulatory agenda for the Department of Labor. It's going to be something we're going to see coming up. I think they're going to address this because it's been so restrictive. And we're going to talk in a little while about the Black Swan case, if anybody has seen that movie, The Black Swan. It's a pretty interesting case that from the interns that worked on that movie brought a case against Fox Productions. And it ended up having a ripple effect on the law. The Department of Labor responded, the Obama administration at the time was in office and they responded, and now we're seeing a new administration and some changes in it. So we're going to talk about internships in a minute, but there are some limited exceptions, and the Department of Labor is going to be looking at that even close. So the first thing, as I said, the first thing we're looking at is, what do they do? What tasks are they doing? And, of course, we're all kind of shaking our head. This seems like an obvious thing. Okay, they can't We don't want kids doing hazardous work. But it's kind of interesting because the Department of Labor has a very, very long and detailed list of what is hazardous work. Now, some of it, okay, storing explosives, I think we'd all agree that's pretty hazardous. You know, there's kind of obvious ones, but driving a motor vehicle is one of them. You know, working as an outside helper on motor vehicles, coal mining, firefighting, power-driven tools, and then they have all these different regs underneath about what tools. So they even have bakery tools as a list, one of the listed power tools they can't do. Manufacturing brick, tile, or related products. You know, they can't operate saws, wrecking or demolition, roofing or work on a roof, trenching or excavating. So there's a pretty long list of what the employee can do. So, and somebody just asked a great question. They said, what if the miner is in one state, is working in one state and a resident of a different state? You want to make sure that you're following where the miner is actually performing work. You need to make sure that you are in compliance with the state laws of that state. Now, one of the things that's interesting with regard to the hazardous, you know, that miners can't work in hazardous conditions or doing hazardous work, is that this is really the only restriction that applies to 16 and 17 year olds. So under 18, anyone under 18, this ban on working in hazardous work, but it's pretty much the only restriction for 16 and 17 year olds. So when we're looking based on age, when we start with the 16 and 17 year olds, there's no limit on working hours. They can't work, you know, they can work in any job as long as it's not one that's listed by the Department of Labor as hazardous. And if you're not sure, just go onto the Department of Labor's website and look up hazardous work, and it'll pull up. There's a listing of all of it. And they've got to be paid federal minimum wage. Now, one of the things that is interesting, though, that does apply to anyone under 18, employment of minors, is that they can be paid what's called a training wage for the first 90 days of their employment, which might be throughout the whole summer. You know, there's some restrictions on this, but they're not a lot. That if they're under 20, they can be paid a youth minimum wage, which is actually $4.25 an hour. Now, you need to be careful because, you know, as I said before, we definitely want to look at the states, because state minimum wage may be higher and may be mandated even for minors in your state. So make sure you take a look if you're going to use a lower rate. So now let's go to, I'm going to kind of go to both ends. So first we looked at the older kids, the 16 and 17 year olds, and now let's look at the ones who are younger, the under 14. And basically under the federal law, 14 is effectively the minimum age for employment with very, very limited exceptions. So if you're under 14, you know, what can you do? What can your 13 year old do or your 12 year old do? I mean, they can deliver newspapers, they can babysit, and of course they can always act and perform for money. There's not a limit on that. We see babies that are working. But there's definitely restrictions on hours and what type of work they can do. So that's basically the gist of anybody who's under 14. So now what about these middle ages, you know, the 14 and 15 year olds. Once you're 14, there's definitely a lot less restrictions than the under 14. You can do office and clerical work, you know, artistic work, stocking shelves, limited food service. You know, they can't work in the kitchen for the most part, but they can serve. Washing vehicles, yard work, but there are, as I said before, we're either looking at the kind of work or we are looking at the number of hours that they're working. And so when we're talking about 14 and 15-year-olds, we're going to look at how long they work, how many hours in the day are they working, how many hours in a week. And what's interesting is they talk about, the Fair Labor Standards Act talks about school days and non-school days. Now, that's really hard because, you know, schools run on different schedules. There are schools that run year-round. You may have schools that get out at different times in your community. This is really very fact-based, but a good just rule of thumb if you're trying to say, okay, I don't know, you know, I'm trying to make sure that I'm good, you know, with complying with the FLSA with regard to minors and the number of hours worked is to look to your local public schools. If they're the local public schools are out and the employees are, you know, not working, then generally that can, you know, that's how you can set your policy on hours. But you do need to know if your employee is at another school and is going to school, that will affect the hours that employee can work. So here's the difference for 14 and 15-year-olds. If school is in session, it's during a in session, then we're looking at, first of all, they can only work during between 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. And again, we are talking about, this is the federal law. State laws may have more restrictions on this. It has to be outside of school hours, so this is during whenever your community's school year is. And max, they can only work 3 hours on a school day, 8 hours on a school day, and the most they can work in a work week is 18 hours when someone is 14 or 15 years old. Now, what happens if school's not in session? If school's not in session, then they actually have extended hours under the federal law. They can work till 9 o'clock at night, but only from June 1st until Labor Day, so during the summer. Those, it's interesting, though, they don't have the extended hours during winter breaks, like around Christmas. So now this one, maximum of 8 hours a day, maximum of 40 hours a week, which means if it's a maximum of 40 hours a week, not allowed to work 14 and 15-year-olds overtime. Let me get to the next one. So one of the things when we're talking about hiring minors, you know, somebody just asked me about seasonal work. You know, seasonal work is, when you're talking about minors, it is for the period of time that the minors are not in school and you are hiring them for that particular season. But even when you're applying any laws regarding seasonal workers, you still have to look at the state law requirements, you know, regarding employment of minors if they are under the age of 18. So what's the tips now for hiring minors? First of all, now a lot of states require that you get age certificates to confirm that the employees, you know, that the employee is the age that they are telling you they are. I recommend getting them anyway. I mean, you know, you don't need it if somebody's 16. Obviously, you can use a driver's license. But if somebody's under 16 and they're telling you, you know, they're 15 and you're allowing them to do some things that only 14 and 15-year-olds are, you may want to ask them for an age certificate to verify their age. You also want to make sure that you stress safety in the workplace on things that they're doing and clearly outline the job duties to make sure you communicate with that minor employee what they are permitted to do and also what they are not permitted to do. Make sure, you know, that they are properly supervised, that they're not, you know, going off and doing something that they're not supposed to be doing, because in the end it'll come back and haunt you. And make sure they're keeping careful track of working hours. You definitely don't want people working off the clock. You want them to understand, you know, sometimes they haven't been in the workforce and do not understand the concept of off-the-clock work. We definitely don't want off-the-clock work, especially when you are being, you know, when there is you know, when there's a possibility that when there's a restriction on their hours. So you definitely want to make sure that you're complying with that. And the best way to comply with that is to make sure that the employee is keeping track of their hours. And also, I can't stress this enough, make sure you are checking state law, because this is an area that is just more restrictive under state law. So now let's talk about the internships. You know, this is an area that is in, has gone through such flux in the past about, you know, and it was actually really for me, as an employment attorney, it was frustrating for a long time, because it seems that I'm an advocate of internships. I think that and I'm not commenting whether they should be paid or non-paid, but it's just a great way for young people in college or just getting out of college or in high school to learn about different professions and work in them and see if they like them. But there have been a lot of restrictions on it because, quite honestly, some of these students were being taken advantage of and being worked very hard and not getting paid for it. And so the question is, do we need to pay them? You know, can we have these summer internships? And I'm using summer because we're, you know, that's my theme, and you guys are probably going to get sick of my summer metaphors by the end of this hour. But we're really talking about internships in general. This is the, there's no specific requirements other than the FLSA requirements we were just talking about employing minors. When we're talking about summer internships, the internships apply even if you have one during the school year, so or anytime during the year. So the FLSA generally, and I want to emphasize the word generally, requires that if you are a for-profit employer, you've got to pay your employees for your work, minimum wage and overtime. And that's kind of the, you know, that this would be an exception to that. You know, and interns, you know, they cost a lot less. It's free help, and it's great, and the interns, you know, we don't have to give them benefits, and we can get some help in, and the internships can learn about our trade, but it's a strict test, it's difficult to pass, and if you don't pass it, they're employees, and you'll owe them back wages, you could owe them possibly back overtime, you could owe, you know, you'll have to pay their portion of any employee taxes. So there's a big penalty if you have misclassified them or if your internship is not compliant. So what happened, though, is this year, and this is just one of the reasons I want to talk about this, is because we're going to talk about three or four things that have happened in 2018 with the Department of Labor. We're starting to see the Department of Labor move sort of away from the more the stricter tenets that it had under the prior administration, and now that Secretary Acosta, the Secretary of the Department of Labor, Alexander Acosta, has been in office now almost a year, we're starting to see the Department of Labor move more to his agenda and loosen some of these restrictions. So in January of 2018, the Department of Labor did an updated guidance to identify the primary beneficiary of the relationship in determining whether an employment relationship exists. Now, this has always sort of been where the touchstone of what the Department of Labor looks at is who is benefiting from this relationship, and the primary beneficiary should be the intern, not the employer. That's always been the case, but it's been a pretty restrictive test to in order for somebody to come under and pass the test of being an unpaid intern under the Department of Labor regulations, and they have definitely loosened that. But what, as I said before, what started it was it was a response in part to the string of intern lawsuits that started in 2011, where two interns sued Fox Searchlight Pictures for their work on the movie Black Swan, and they said, we were working, you know, a ton of hours, we were just fetching coffee and drinks and doing this and doing that, and we didn't get paid for it, which, you know, to get an internship on a movie is highly sought after. You know, people would, you know, I'll pay you to let me work on this movie. But it sort of stirred things up. And after these two interns came forward and brought this lawsuit, there was a string of other ones. We saw there was a bunch against Columbia Music. We saw some other lawsuits come back where other internships in the entertainment business, where these were very coveted positions, that these people were saying, well, why aren't I getting paid? And in the first part of the lawsuit, in the lower court, they won. And the court said, you know, you didn't satisfy, the DOL has a 6 criteria for an unpaid internship, and you didn't meet it. Well, then it ended up going to the appellate court, And the appellate, and by this time there was all these interns. The decision was reversed, and they found that the DOL standards on unpaid internships were too rigid. They ended up settling, and I don't even think they made a lot of money. I mean, I think the interns were getting about $7,500 each. Now, somebody just asked a great question. You know, if this intern, if we've got somebody that turns out to be an intern, and I mean that. We have this intern that is working for us, and we don't meet the requirements of the DOL, or we're not sure if we meet the requirements. Can we pay them a stipend? If the person is determined to be an employee and you don't meet the summer internship program, you have to pay them just like you would pay an employee. You are an employee or you're not an employee. So a stipend. What happens usually with the stipends is the stipend is for people who technically would meet the qualifications for an unpaid internship. So we have these cases, and the next thing we know, in January of this year, the Department of Labor goes in and they try to take another swipe at their primary beneficiary test. So the first requirement is that both parties understand that the intern is not entitled to compensation, that this is an agreement, that the employee is well aware that they are not going to get paid and they sign off on it. Now, here's the biggest kicker on this. One of the things that they have to do is they have to provide training that would be given in an educational environment. So there has to be an actual program on this. And this is one of the ones that I thought was interesting that this stayed in, because this was one of the elements that was sort of criticized. So there has to be a training element that the employee is learning and observing and getting a chance to participate in it. The internship's completion of the program entitles him or her to academic credit. Now, not any of these are determinative. These are just factors that they are looking at, okay? So if they don't get credit, that doesn't mean that you cannot have an unpaid internship. The internship corresponds with an academic calendar. This is, again, just things that they're looking at now. The duration is limited period of time where you're educating them. They're actually completing an internship. They meet certain criteria that they are learning or mastering. The internship's work, and this is a big one. This is what they're going to be looking at. The work that they're, as I said before, they're always looking at who's benefiting from it, okay? So the primary beneficiary is the intern, and that the work that they're doing is just complementing the work you already have somebody else doing. That's okay, because they're learning. But if you have somebody doing work instead of your employee, like I'm going to have this, I'm going to take this task from one of my employees and have my intern do it this summer, that's a problem. That's an employee. So you have to be really careful with the duties when you have an unpaid internship. And the intern and the employer understand that the internship is conducted without entitlement to a job at the end, that we're not working toward getting a job. Now, I will say that the for-profit and public entities – nonprofit and public entities, they are a lot more lax with these requirements as long as you have a structure to your internship. If we're not somebody asked a question, what if they are we're not paying them and they're just observing and not working. I think if somebody is not actually, what makes an employee is that person is performing tasks for the benefit of the employer. If somebody is performing zero tasks and they're just observing, I think you're fine. But I'd be very careful if you're having them come for a certain hours, anything that could be interpreted to be to your benefit would weigh to the side of an employee. But if the person's not performing any tasks for you and they are literally just observing what you do and have the ability to come and go, you know, maybe within some structures of when you're allowing them to come observe, I think that would be fine to be an unpaid internship to that. Somebody asked this is a great question and one that I bet a bunch of people have. Can an intern sign an agreement waiving any payment issues? The answer to that is no, because the Fair Labor Standards Act is very strict. You are not allowed anybody. You are not allowed to waive your rights under the Fair Labor Standards Act. Just like you can't come to an agreement with one of your employees that, look, I'm going to pay you X number of dollars and that's going to cover your overtime and, you know, I'm just going to pay you this, or I'm going to pay you X number of dollars and it's under minimum wage, but you agree to take it. You cannot waive your rights under the Fair Labor Standards Act. That is why there are so many restrictions on settling FLSA cases where, you know, in most jurisdictions, you can't have a private settlement without the DOL or court's approval, that otherwise they're not enforceable. So the answer to that is no, that a student cannot waive their right to get paid. That in and of itself is not going to protect you from a future wage claim. You can't say, well, they agreed to sign this, that they were taking. In fact, I even think the interns, I don't remember for sure, but I even think the interns on the Black Swan project had signed an agreement saying that they were unpaid interns. They had acknowledged it. So, you know, as I said before, no one factor controls. The primary focus needs to be education. You know, that, yes, this is a program that we have. We're letting people come in. They get to do this. They're learning this. They're learning that. They're helping us, but they're not replacing our workers who are in charge of those things. You know, that's where you need to focus. That's when we're talking about the primary beneficiary. You know, this is something, as I said before, the Department of Labor has opportunity, especially for 16 and for minors, but this is kind of on their radar. I'm sorry. Hello. Am I making everybody crazy? I went back too far. I did it again. Sorry. This is one of the things that we're going to see, I think we're going to see in the future, we're going to talk about in a minute, that's on the DOL's radar about apprentices, apprenticeships, about internships to give. There's a push now to that people are saying, come on, you know, this is, if somebody's willing to do this, I think there's more restrictions on it when there's a minor. And somebody just asked a question about that minimum, that training wage for the 425. Does it only apply to minors? That is, yes, it is a youth. That is a youth, called the youth minimum wage. So, if you do have an unpaid internship, I would definitely have your attorney take a look at it and make sure you're in compliance, because you definitely don't want to end up in an internship lawsuit like a lot of employers have seen. They have just been popping up all over the place, and I think that's one of the reasons the Department of Labor decided to address it this year. So also going forward, you know, one of the things that has – I love the summer metaphor, we're going to jump in the pool for tip pooling. This has been, I know anybody who's in the restaurant business is probably fully aware of this and knows that this has been an ongoing debate on who can share tips when we've got tipped employees. And, you know, this all starts because one of the exceptions to the federal minimum wage is that you can pay an employee what's called a tip credit. And you're allowed to count up to $4.12 per hour of an employee's tips against their total wage. Now, you'll see people talking about the tip credit being $2.13 an hour, but that's really just for the federal minimum wage, because if you're like here, you know, I'm in Florida, we have a higher minimum wage, so that tip credit would have to be higher. We can take $5.12 of of the money can come from tips and the rest needs to be their minimum wage, which is obviously going to be less than the federal or state minimum wage. So we're going to take a credit for their tips, and at the end of the day, their tips have to bring them to minimum wage. So if the tips that an employee is credited do not bring them to your state or federal or the federal minimum wage, the employer has to make up the difference. So you don't get the tip credit, though, if an employer is taking a portion of the tips, or the tip pool, let's say we're putting money into a pool, or even the tip pool, or if it's not even pooled, even if you're just requiring an employee to share their tips with managers or employees, or managers or employees who do not customarily and regularly receive at least $30 per month in tips. And that's generally in a restaurant considered the back of the house, the cooks, the dishwashers, and stuff. So if your tip pool, if an employer takes a portion of it, or if an employer makes you turn in a portion of your tips, or if an employer makes an employee share their tips with the restaurant manager or with the back of the house, or the tip pool does that, you lose your tip credit. You have to pay them at least the minimum wage. So, but what happens when they're not taking a tip, an employer's not taking a tip credit? You know, are there still restrictions on the tip pooling? Well, under the Obama administration, they said yes. You know, they said the restrictions on tip pools that you can't share with the back of the house apply regardless of whether you take a tip credit. So, you know, the whole thing with the tip credit was, look, you're paying these people a lower hourly amount, you're using their tips to make them come up to it, and we've got restrictions on who can share in those tips. Under the Obama administration, it says we don't care what your base pay is. Even if you're paying them minimum wage and they're getting a portion of the tips, those tips belong to the employee, and you're not permitted to share them even with managers or hostesses or back of the house. But then the Obama administration came in, and also some federal courts weighed in, and they disagreed. They said, well, the FLSA only governs minimum wage. So it only all the statute cares about is how much the employee is taking, you know, taking home and is being paid. Are they paying the minimum wage? That's all the Department of Labor cares about. I mean, the Fair Labor Standards Act cares about. So what employers do with the tips for employees who are paid the full minimum wage is their business. And so there was kind of a split, and nobody was sure where we were going to go with it. And there's lots of back and forth and debate on it. Well, in March of this year, President Obama signed a massive spending bill and budget, and it was interesting. The thing was like 2,200 pages, and everybody says it was buried in there, but excuse me, on page 2000, I thought it was funny what page it was on. It was on page 2021 of the bill, is actually an amendment to the Fair Labor Standards Act. I mean, this omnibus bill actually amended the federal law on wage and hour, and it said an employer may not keep tips received by its employees for any purposes, including allowing a manager or supervisor to keep any employee's tips. So just allowing, you know, that employer can't keep it, that includes you can't let your managers keep it, and that doesn't matter whether you whether or not you take the tip credit, okay, which sort of seemed to go a little bit against what the Obama administration, I mean, the Trump administration had been saying, because they kind of said, well, the tips are yours, you know, the tips get, what does it matter if you're paying a minimum wage? But this said, no, it doesn't matter whether you're paying a minimum wage, an employer, and that means, you know, a manager is by virtue a representative of the employer, they are the employer. Employer or manager cannot take a portion of the tips. And they call it the Tip Income Protection Act, and it says 2013. I'm sorry, that should be 2018. I apologize, that's a typo. The Tip Income Protection Act of 2018. Any employer who buy it, and then it actually has in the In the bill that he signed, it said if you violate the rule, you'll be liable for not only for the amount of the tips that were taken, but double that and possibly a civil penalty. So, but here's what's interesting. It also reversed the 2011 rule under President Obama that said you can't share your tips with anybody, you know, because under President Obama, under the Obama administration, the Department of Labor had a rule regulation saying that you couldn't share even with back of the house or anybody who didn't customarily and regularly receive tips. That rule was overturned. So while right now the new law is that if you do pay minimum wage, you cannot share the tips with employers or managers, but you can still share with employees who do not customarily receive tips, such as the back of the house. So where does that leave us? If you maintain a tip pooling arrangement, you should carefully examine it to make sure, you know, you're in compliance in light of the new law. If you take a tip credit, not much has changed because the same restrictions apply on tip pooling as before. So if you're taking that lesser amount and making it up with tips, they can't include management or supervisory employees, and they also cannot include back of the house, anyone who doesn't customarily or regularly receive tips. But if you don't take a tip credit, if you're paying the employees minimum wage and then they're getting tips on top of that, you still have to exclude those managers and supervisors, and you need to make sure that you're not taking any proper deductions, such as, you know, processing fees or anything like that. You can't take deductions from the employee. But you can have the employee share their tips with the back of the house. And you want to also, again, make sure that you're in compliance because there are some states that have some restrictions with regard to tips as well. So I had said earlier that we can see the Department of Labor kind of starting to make a move of a little bit less restrictive regulations and overturning a lot of the regulations that many thought were very, very restrictive. And while I'm seeing an increase, which is crazy because they've had pretty severe budget cuts, the Department of Labor has. We've seen an increase in audits lately. They're also doing this outreach right now. And I was just discussing this with one of my partners in the firm that the Department of Labor has this new program called PAID. And basically, and you guys are probably going to look, I put this emoji on there because I'm sure this is going to be your expression when I tell you what it is, that you voluntarily submit to a DOL audit. And let me walk you through what this is and why it may be something you just might want to consider going forward. This is kind of a unique thing. PAID stands for Payroll Audit Independent Determination. And it's a new program, and it's supposed to facilitate resolution. It's supposed to be a way that if you know you're doing something wrong, you can fix it and get it sanctioned by the Department of Labor. Technically, if you look on their website, it says it's a six-month program. I just had a meeting with the Department of Labor a couple weeks ago in Atlanta on an audit I'm working on, and we mentioned that it was a pilot program, and they all looked at me like I had four heads, and they're like, no, it's not a pilot program. So I was like, well, your website says it is. So technically, it's supposed to be a six-month pilot program, but I definitely think it's something that's being implemented now. I don't think the Department of Labor has any intention of moving away from it. I will say, though, that I deal with the Department of Labor a lot, and I find that the investigators who are doing PAID right now have had very basic training on it and don't seem to have an in-depth knowledge you know, what we need to look at then is what's going to happen going forward. We're not sure. It just started in April, so we're looking at a very early onset of this and early beginnings. So what you do is you basically conduct a self-audit. If you discover FLSA violations, you self-report them to the Department of Labor. The Department of Labor then you actually do the calculations. They look at your calculations. They do a supposedly limited investigation, and then you're supposed to pay 100% of what these employees are owed, and then you get releases for them. There's a couple of restrictions on it. You can't be involved in any litigation involving the pay practice. So if you are being sued saying you've misclassified someone as exempt who is non-exempt, you cannot be part of the paid program during that, and you can't be under investigation by the Department of Labor. Now, I had an investigator tell me recently that you can't have been subject to a DOL audit. I don't think that that's necessarily true, but I don't think that's what they say, and I'm actually involved in one right now where the Department of Labor, I'm involved in an audit for a client, a DOL audit, and we have talked to the Department of Labor about going into a paid program for this client, and the Department of Labor has been agreeable to it. So my belief is you can't be under a current investigation to go into paid. So anyway, what's the process for this thing? First, what you do is you conduct a self-audit, and let's say you say, I'm not sure about this job. Okay. Employer conducts a self-audit. They say, I'm not sure whether these independent contractors really should be employees. I've been treating these people as salaried exempt, and I'm reading some stuff now, and I think they might be non-exempt. I'm not sure I'm doing my regular rate calculations correct. You do it, and let's say you find, okay, you have somebody come in and do it, and you say, I realize that I am non-compliant right now. And I have X number of employees who need to be fixed. Well, you go through the application process, and you have to first do this participation. You have to go through these online materials, and then once you go through these materials and you can go through this process, and the DOL assures you, I'm not, take it for what it's worth. I can't tell you whether this is true or not, but they do state that the application process in and of itself will not trigger an audit. So if they say you are not qualified because you have litigation or because you've had a prior audit or whatever reason that you're not qualified for paid, that doesn't mean they're going to come in and it won't. They say it doesn't trigger an investigation unless there's a health or safety risk. But the employer applies for paid, reports to DOL. You have to say your specific violations and an explanation. You have to say the employees that are affected by this, the time frames that are affected, and you actually do the initial calculations and say this is what we think they're owed. The DOL says on their website they want this to be 90 days. That's generally what the Department of Labor strives for in all their audits. I'm involved in one right now that's been going on for a year, so take that with a grain of salt. But one of the things I thought was interesting is, according to the Department of Labor, when you go through paid, I think they consider it an expedited process, and you have to pay the next pay period. Normally, you've got at the conclusion of a DOL audit, normally they will give you 60 days to pay, but this it looks like underpaid, they're doing it more expedited, and you only you have to do it in the next pay period. So why do it? You know, everyone is probably like, whoa, why would we voluntarily bring the federal government to go look at us? Well, here's, you know, as I said before, somebody asked about signing off on the internships. Can somebody sign it away? When you have a violation of the Fair Labor Standards Act, somebody is misclassified, you haven't been doing your calculations correctly, you can correct it, but then the employee can sue for back wages up to 3 years. If it's found to be willful, they can get liquidated damages. And if somebody sues and you're found to owe a single dollar, then they get their attorney's fees. And sometimes the attorney's fees can well exceed what the employee is owed. And so there's a lot of kind of factors out there. And in order to settle with them, the court has to bless it. So when you're dealing with the Department of Labor, we're not looking at liquidated damages. That is part of being in the paid program. You don't have to pay double. They're only going to go back 2 years. They're not going to go back 3 years. There'll be no civil money, monetary damages, and no attorney's fees. So it limits your liability. Also, you are getting a DOL waiver. The DOL, when you do your calculations and you say, okay, I had 10 employees in this position and we calculated that they're owed, you know, $2,800 each, the DOL will fill out what's called a WH-58. That is their waiver form for each employee, and the employee acknowledges and signs that by accepting the check, they are waiving their right to go after the third year or the liquidated damages or any of the additional amounts. They're accepting the money and waiving their right to sue under the Fair Labor Standards Act. And it also is, if you do get sued, it is a defense that we are, you know, we have worked with the DOL and we have corrected this going forward. So there are some benefits of it if you know that you've got a violation and you're not sure how to handle it and you want to try to limit your exposure. Now, here's what some of the people have voiced as concerns with it. And some of these I agree with. I understand some of the concerns. But, you know, so if an employee, you know, one thing, and we don't know, if an employer's audit in the future was a new violations be deemed repeat violations that could result in penalties. You know, I brought this up to an investigator you know, he said that he didn't know, but that the DOL is really pushing this program. They want people to participate in it. They want people to voluntarily come forward. So that he thought that they weren't going to penalize somebody who was trying to fix things. And I was like, well, what if they were trying to fix things and they continued not to? And he said, well, maybe, you know, that maybe it would subject to penalties. So I think that would be really fact-specific. But the other thing is that you've admitted that you reclassified someone, you know, that you did something incorrectly, and what if you're not accepted into the program or if an employee refuses to sign a WH-58 because an employee is never required to sign a WH-58? You know, that is true. I mean, that is a risk, you know, that you might go into this and the employee might still sue you, but you'll have a calculation that's been approved by the Department of Labor. You'll have a determination, you know, you'll have be able to show a court that you voluntarily went this, that you recognize this issue. So I think it'd be harder for somebody who sued you to get that third year and that those liquidated damages. You know, I just think that it would help in the lawsuit as well. But and the other part of it is, and depending on what state you're in, especially if you're in a state like California, if you guys have a location in a state like California that has daily overtime besides the annual, the weekly overtime, is that state there's no these WH-58 only waive the federal law claim. So if the state has a state statute that was violated as well, you could still end up with a state claim. But an employee generally doesn't get two bites of the apple. You can show that this employee has been paid. So that's just a program. I think it's here to stay, and it might be something that if you have something, a violation, you might want to consider it. So I've alluded to the changes in the DOL law. So what's coming down the pike? You know, I know a lot of you were on my emails as we followed the overtime law through the initial draft, and then it was about to take place on December 1st, and then the court stopped it, and then we got a new president. So everybody's kind of waiting, like, is anything going to happen to the overtime exemption laws, and where are we? So this is what's on the regulatory agenda for the Department of Labor. They say in August they're going to come up with some regulations regarding tips. So we're going to see some actual regulations and specifics, hopefully some clarification on tip pooling and tip credits. September 2018, they said that they're going to address regular rate, which I think is great. And I don't have any. I wasn't going to talk in detail about regular rate before, but if you have not attended one of my webinars before, regular rate is what is used to calculate overtime, not hourly rate. So what we do for regular rate is we take all the compensation that was paid to an employee in a given week. So if somebody gets a bonus or any additional compensation, we divide by the number of hours the employee works, and that is the regular rate, and they get time and a half of that rate for purposes of overtime. And it's very confusing, and there's lots of errors in it, so hopefully we're going to see the DOL streamlining those regulations. As I said before, they want to talk about minors and apprenticeships and employment opportunities for minors. So they say that they're going to come out in October of 2018 with some guidance on that. So, and of course, where are we on the overtime exemptions? They said they're going to define and delimiting the overtime exemptions. And everybody's been waiting. And if you remember, they did Department of Labor did a request for information in July asking all these detailed questions about how exemptions are applied and what do they use. And all the, you know, they got a ridiculous amount of responses, and they kept it open, I think, until September. And so everyone was waiting to see. And Secretary Acosta has said that he thinks that the salary threshold for exemption is too low. He thought it was too high when they were going to move it up to almost $47,000, but he definitely has indicated that he thinks a bump is necessary. So, it is now, it's been pushed back again, and now it is on DOL's agenda for January of 2019. They say they're going to come to the, they're going to address the exemption. So it's going to be very interesting to see what happens. Just to round out our hour, I've just got a couple more things. We're going to talk, there's just been two Supreme Court cases that have an effect on employment law, and one of them is a little removed from wage and hour, but it does affect wage and hour cases. Another one's directly on point for wage and hour issues. The first one is this. I put epic win because I think people were just very surprised by it. In a 5-4 decision that just happened a few weeks ago, the United States Supreme Court ruled that class action and collective action, which is a collective action is a in a class action, you have to opt out of the class. If you meet the definition of the class, you're automatically in the class unless you opt out. For a collective action, which are what are collective actions are under the Fair Labor Standards Act, you have to actually opt into the class. So let's say all cashiers during a certain period of time, if you work during that time and you want to be part of a lawsuit, a Fair Labor Standards lawsuit for overtime, you have to opt into the class. So these waivers in arbitration agreements, the Supreme Court said, do not violate the law. There had been some rulings that they did, and there was this, the National Labor Relations Board had kind of gone after them and said that these class waivers to require an employee to sign a class waiver is unenforceable. And so the three cases were consolidated because this issue was so prevalent. They consolidated three cases, and it went all the way to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said, nope, you can use them. So collective and class waivers in your employment arbitration agreements will be enforceable. So if you have an arbitration agreement that says to employees you are required to arbitrate not bring a lawsuit regarding any matters arising out of your employment, and you can say, and this waives your right to be bring or be part of a class or collective action against us, that is enforceable. Now, there's still traditional contract defenses such as unconscionability. I mean, they can still argue, you know, they signed under duress or whatever, but the waiver itself is now considered to be enforceable. So that's good news. The second Supreme Court case was in April. And the Supreme Court held that service advisors at an automobile dealership are exempt. Now, okay, if you're not an automobile dealership, you probably don't care about that. But what's interesting, it's not the exemption ruling that made this case so memorable. What's interesting is for the last 70 years, you know, if you've been on my webinars before, you know, I've talked in detail about the three exemption, the three main white collar exemptions from overtime: executive, administrative, and professional, and that you have to meet these job duty tests to qualify to be exempt from overtime. And they have always been very narrowly construed. And after 70 years of interpreting these, the court said, no, they shouldn't be narrowly construed. We're going to just look for a fair interpretation. So when they were narrowly construed, they were always construed in favor of the employee not being exempt from overtime. And so now the courts are is abandoning that and saying, no, we're going to look at a fair interpretation of it. And this broader interpretation is probably going to result in fewer certifications of class actions, collective actions, and probably be harder for a plaintiff to get a case thrown out on summary judgment. So that is definitely good news. So it looks like I'm at 59 minutes and 30 seconds. I just came in under the mark, and I appreciate everyone being here today. Please fill out the survey and give us some insight on your thoughts and any topics you would like to see in the future. And I'm going to stick around for a couple minutes and try to answer some of these questions if you'd like to stay on. So let me just get to a couple of these. Somebody asked if the paid program would be applicable for a misclassification of an independent contractor. Yes. I mean, basically, the way I understand paid and the way it says it on their website and through my conversations with the Department of Labor, it is for when you find any violation, when you believe that you have any violation of the Fair Labor Standards Act. So if you have not been treating someone as an employee who is an employee and entitled to the rights under the Fair Labor Standards Act, that would be a violation that would be subject to paid. Somebody asked if an employer suspects that employees in one job classification are incorrectly classified as exempt and enrolls in paid, does that open them up to a wider view? According to the Department of Labor, no. That the Department of Labor does not expand and that they will not it doesn't open them up to they say it doesn't. I have to believe, at least in the short term, that they're going to stick to that because they want people to participate in this program. They want employers to come forward and work with them to correct misclassifications, incorrect calculations, and all of those things. And so my understanding is that paid, when they do the limited investigation on paid, they're limited to the scope of what you have brought to them. They do not make a bigger one, and it doesn't trigger another audit. I can only speak to what the Department of Labor has said to me. I don't know for sure if it's true. The program's only been around since April, so some of it we'll have to wait and see. And honestly, it may be something where you may – I know it's hard because if you think you have a violation, you know, you're racking up liability, but it may be something that you might want to wait and see a little bit to see how these – how this program plays out. Somebody asked, how do you enroll in paid? There is, you go to the Department of Labor's website, and there's information. It's an online program to begin with, and you'll go through a whole process of what you need to do in order to participate in it. So I think I've answered pretty much everybody's questions. Thanks again for being here, and I hope everyone has a great summer.